So I've talked about this paper quite a bit in the last couple of days. One more time, okay? Again, it's been cited 2,000 times. It's one of those very, very influential papers. And you remember this graph that we talked about, what Richard and I talked about. And notice that one of the axes of that graph is AUC, very end of the curve. And it goes up to about 0.75, and 0.5 would be down here. And what you can see is that all of these methods fall kind of in this 0.65 to 0.75 region. I'm going to come back to how much we should believe that. Okay? We've already talked about a number of problems with this paper, and I'm going to come back to one more. For the moment, I want you to look at some quotes that I pulled out of three papers that were published recently that I could get off the internet very easily. In the threshold independent evaluation, we tested the performance of the max-out scenarios using ROC analysis and pseudo-absence in place of absence localities. That's all correct. AUC is typically used as a measure of model performance. Okay. Did they talk about how they split the data? No. All they did was take the statistic out of the max end output. There wasn't any careful data splitting. Another paper, the model was developed for occurrences within the data. Occurrence data were divided into training data and test data, 25%. Resulting model was evaluated with an ROC curve. Okay. Random splitting. You have random splitting and you haven't controlled for spatial autocorrelation, you might have a calibration point and an evaluation point right next to each other. Just like in the Elif et al. Example that I showed you. Remember? So all I'm trying to show you with these little vignettes is that the community has gotten very careless. Essentially, the Elif et al. Paper more or less debuted this technique for niche modeling and distribution modeling, and now the whole community uses it rather blindly. So then this paper comes out by Jorge Lobo, Alberto Jimenez Valverde, and Raimundo Real. It's a pretty important paper. Everybody ignores it because it's not very convenient. It points out that the ROC approach can be a very bad idea. And so every paper I review that makes these mistakes, I say, please read the Lobo et al. Paper, cite it, and respond appropriately. And usually what they do is they cite it. Lobo et al. Pointed out problems with the ROC approach in species distribution modeling and ecological niche modeling. Nonetheless, we used ROC analysis to, I'm serious, watch, you'll see. Read the literature, you'll see what I mean. So I'm going to summarize what Lobo et al. Had to say about ROC. Then I'm going to illustrate some of the ones that I think are most meaningful. First of all, it ignores the predicted probability values. It's based on just a ranking. So you might have a suitability that goes from 0.99, 0.98, 0.97, 0.6, 0.62, right? Well, all that matters is the ranking. And these ones that were separated by 1/100 are the same as the ones that are separated by 0.3. Okay, so it's a relative ranking. It ignores the actual values. I'm going to illustrate this next one, but ROC analysis includes information from regions of the ROC plot that are pretty much irrelevant. And I'll illustrate that for you in a moment. It weights omission and commission errors equally. You guys should remember that omission error is based on presence data, and so we should be really concerned about it. And commission error is based on absence data, which we don't have. It's made up data. Okay? So we do not want anything that weights omission error and commission errors equal. Which is to say, in the confusion matrix, A and D, which are both correct prediction, A is much more important than D because it's a correct prediction of presences. And same for incorrect prediction of presences versus incorrect prediction of absences, we need to weight omission error more than commission error. Third, we don't get any information about the spatial distribution of model errors. And fourth, I'll illustrate this for you as well, the study area extent determines the entire outcome. That goes back to the paper about M. Okay? You have to make a robust assumption about the extent of M. Otherwise, the outcome of your model evaluation is whatever you want it to be. If you want it to be significant, pick a bigger area. Okay, so just to illustrate a few of those points for you, remember, this is the omission axis and this is the commission axis. And you should think that a unit in this direction is weighted the same as a unit in this direction. So omission and commission error both participate in creating that perfect model equals area under the curve of 1.0. So omission and commission error are weighted equal. You could, in theory, if you knew how bad your absence data were, you could compact or expand different axes. That would be pretty easy to do. Okay? People don't do that. The other point that I wanted to make for you is this, where, okay, check the cameras are on. The other point that I wanted to make for you is this red oval. You can think about each one of these thresholds, essentially each vertical line that I could draw through this graph. You can think of each one of these thresholds as being a model. Okay? Okay, they're a different thresholding of our original ramp of suitabilities. These models out here, let's take this one that predicts 60% of the study area at present, and then achieves about an 82% correct classification rate of presences. That's a model that maybe I can use it. Think about this model. I predict 20% of the study area as suitable. And when I challenge my model to predict independent occurrence data, it fails half the time. Do you really want to interpret a model that fails half the time, that can't predict half of the independent occurrence points? That sounds like a pretty crummy model. But notice that that is participating in the area under the curve. And as I'll argue in just a moment, I really don't care about this part of this curve. Because those are models, they're predictions, that really do a bad job when you challenge them with independent occurrence data. Here's another illustration of Lobo et al.'s points. This is a ROC curve based on a rather snug M study area. But I could expand that. And essentially what that does is, under a couple assumptions, but it basically just moves each of these points to the left. And so essentially what you're doing is you're saying that in every case my model covers less of the study area. It's akin to keeping that whiteboard the same size, but making the wall bigger. It's still the same size whiteboard, And it's still, if I'm throwing darts at it from over here, it's still just as hard or easy to hit. But if the wall is bigger, then that shifts these points to the left. And guess what? My area under the curve increases. So if you don't have a good biological definition of your study area, a good basis for those assumptions about M, then it's really just very subjective. It's not a rigorous test of your model. So, one more problem to show you with rock analysis, and particularly with the Elif et al. Paper. And this was a detail that I had not appreciated until after we wrote that paper. If I take a Maxent model, remember back to those Maxent images that we looked at. Blue was not suitable, and actually red was suitable. How much red did you see? Almost nothing, right? It was mainly around from blue through greens. There is red on those images, but it's tiny little areas. So our Maxent predictions go all the way from this, which is essentially nothing predicted present, to this, which is the whole area predicted present. Okay? And Maxent models characterize this whole spectrum. And I don't mean to pick on Maxent. GAMS and other such algorithms give you a suitability that covers the whole spectrum. Now, GARP, just to take a different example, but I could say the same thing for a bioclinic. GARP does not characterize that whole spectrum. If you were paying attention during the best subsets part, what Enrique was doing was to throw out the model replicates that omitted a lot of points. Omission is here, right, this axis, and so what Enrique was doing in that best subsets discussion that he had with you was to throw out all of these models, which is to say GARP models are designed to throw out those irrelevant portions of the rock curve. So what I did in a paper in 2007, which we'll provide to you, is I developed Maxent models and GARP models for a very, very, very detailed testing data set. And I want you to notice two things about it. One is that GARP doesn't do anything between here and here. GARP are the black dots. Whereas Maxent fleshes out that whole curve. The other thing is, notice that up here where GARP does make a prediction, GARP and Maxent have essentially exactly the same performance. Now, remember we're talking about area under the curve. The area under, for GARP, the area under the curve is this down here. For Maxent, the area under the curve is this down here. What I want you to think about is that where GARP even tries, its performance is the same as Maxent. But it loses when we calculate areas under the curve, simply because it didn't even try out here. Bioclin would get the same punishment. So remember back to that graph in the Elif et al. Paper, where Maxent was up at the upper right, looked great, along with a few other algorithms. And GARP and Bioclin were down to the lower left, and they looked terrible. A lot of that is due to this effect. So it's an artifactual result in that Elif et al. Paper. So a few years ago, with a couple of my students, we worked out an alternative. Let me go back here. Notice right here, there's a point where a given algorithm doesn't even try. Right? We threw out all of those high omission replicates from the GARP. So one thing is, we really want to only interpret these areas under the curve in these areas where the models are triangles, okay? But then the other thing is, think about this axis. That's omission area. And you remember we talked about the E statistic. Enrique introduced it, and then Richard talked about it again. The E statistic is essentially how much garbage is there in your occurrence state. Okay, how much noise is there? And as Enrique talked about, E might be zero.